And so please check our website for future sessions. Tomorrow we will start, by the way, at noon, and all of you are invited to our panel at noon on border health discussion. So with that being said, please allow me to introduce Professor Rimbach. Professor Rimbach was born in Los Angeles. He moved to New Mexico in 1988. He received his MFA in painting from the New Mexico State University. He has taught at Central Texas College and at EPCC, at El Paso Community College, since 2003. He's a member of the Mesilla Valley Fine Arts Co-op Gallery in Mesilla, New Mexico, where he exhibits his work. He has just published his first book, which is a painting retrospective spanning over 30 years of art that include poems and other writings. That book is available through Blurb and Amazon. And so I already checked that out. So please allow me to welcome Professor Rimbach for today's presentation.
Thank you so much, Professor Jaimes. That was a wonderful introduction. And thank you, Border Learning Conference, for inviting me again to do a presentation. Interestingly enough, it coincides with the release of a retrospective, which I had in the back of my mind for a long time, and finally got it together, and then it came in fruition with this at this time. It was published in February. Education has been transformative for me. If you go to the next slide, I went to a community college and got my associates in California, and then I went to Cal State Northridge and I was studying psychology and philosophy, and then I stopped. But I was working full time and I saw some art shows, which is where I think I got a lot of my education. Slow down, go back one for 1 second, where I got a lot of my education because LA has a lot of wonderful museums, and I was influenced by landscape painters, mostly impressionists. And I thought to myself, I could do that. Now I had no education in painting, and I bought the an easel and I bought paints, and I would go out and I would paint. I realized I was lacking some knowledge. So then I went back to college and took night classes just to see what this art language was about, because I realized that for me, you kind of have to go into the world, but then education for me is going out of the world. You're going into this other incubation where things start to happen, but it's not in the world. And then I took that information and I moved to Santa Fe. In Santa Fe, I did a lot of landscape painting. And at that time, I was doing different types of jobs, mostly working with developmentally disabled adults. And I was part of the Jackson class deinstitutionalization of Fort Stanton and Los Lunas, of helping individuals transition to community-based programs. This slide is me painting the landscape. In this case, it's actually Las Cruces. And also, if you see this, the one on the bottom, I'm actually modeling for my students who are drawing me. And the top one is in grad school. It is still kind of miraculous to me that I was a student for so long, and now I'm teaching. I find that interesting. You can move through them now, Lorena, please. I had a passion for landscape. I love the feel of a landscape. I was talking to a friend recently, and one thing I like about landscape is that it's quiet. When you look at a painting, it's quiet, but when you're painting a landscape, you're dealing with airplanes and mufflers and farmers and insects and, in some cases, shotguns and water. And people will come up to you and give you advice about maybe you should be painting in the other direction, or why are you using that color? These landscapes were actually done, some in Las Cruces, but some from photographs of my travels, in this case, Italy. And I do think as an artist, You have to educate yourself in terms of the museums. I think about education as every time I pick up a brush or a pen or a pencil, you have to know to yourself that this is important and that this means something. And stop right here for a second. I write poems and about paintings and about my experience painting, gazing at the fields, gazing at the flowers, spinning like a spider, drawing lines and color, gazing at the stars, gazing at the flowers, spinning like a spider, drawing lines for hours. What I have is a symbiotic relationship of going back and forth between something that I paint, and then I'll study it and write poetry about it. You can shift the slide, Lorena, here. Stop here. I think that education is critical for the formal development of how I've lived and an understanding. Most of my instructors actually never taught me technique. If I asked them about technique, they would tell me to go to the library, which I did. Much of my education is from books and reading about other artists. What I learned in terms of education was the critique and the information you got within the discussion of what the painting was after it was done. And then you would take that information and you would develop and hone your skills based upon that. I'll tell you this, I was not technically the best painter, but what I had was hard work ethic. And that really took me a long way. School also taught me how to think about art in terms of the language of art, the materials, the ideas, the meaning, and the element. And I still struggle with understanding how to put a painting together in terms of composition and form. This painting was actually done about 5 years ago in Las Cruces. You can switch now, Lorena. In recent years, I've been working mostly on collage just because of the nature of having to generate work of a different type without having to go outside. I don't really have the time. Maybe over the summer I will. But I would go to the Robledos. I would go to Dripping Springs. I'd go to Achenbach Canyon. I'd go anywhere in Las Cruces that I could or in the surrounding areas and park my truck and set up and paint. Now, sometimes I would go for continuous weekends to the same spot. And what you learn or what I learned about painting from nature is that light moves. If you look at Impressionist paintings, they've talked about Monet was able to grasp one single moment, maybe 10 minutes of time. Whereas somebody like Paul Cézanne, when you look at his paintings, there's a type of unfolding of time that goes on for maybe 5-6 hours. It's a completely different experience. When I was painting from nature, it really informed my work. When I went back into the studio and thought about how to mix color or how to see things. And the color is different when you're mixing and painting outside than when you're mixing in incandescent lights in your apartment. You can go to the next slide. Education, another example of Achenbach Canyon and actually the drive. This is, I think, where the Bishop's Hat mountains are, where the crystal fields are. You can move to the next one, Lorena. I would go by the river and paint in that area. The struggle of painting outside is formidable. You're dealing with time, you're dealing with materials, you're dealing with the heat and everything else. And it's a completely different experience than when you're painting in the studio. When I was in graduate school, a friend of mine, I had visited a friend in Santa Cruz, California, and he was asking me about what is it like, the program, the graduate program. And as we're walking down the street, on top of this car, there's a cat. And I said, that's interesting because inside the car, there was a cat as well. And I think that the inside cat is dealing with museums and the tradition of painting and other painters, which very much you can learn a great deal in that experience. But the cat on top of the car, that animal is looking at nature and pulling from that directly. And I think that direct experience is critical for the development, So it has to go back and forth. Next, please. I do think that education happens everywhere. I read a lot about artists. I watch films about artists, and everything kind of feeds into my work. Once around this star, I know I can make it up and down this road, longing on this latitude. So much time to think and no time to follow through. All the space between farmhouse, dairy cow, green. These poems are about my experience of when I'm out in nature and when I'm thinking about it. Next, please. Landscape has a lot of variables. Of course, the changing conditions. Some interesting experiences when I was painting up in Abiquiú when I was living in Santa Fe. They don't talk about the insects and the bugs, and a couple times I had to negotiate a rattlesnake. So you have to prepare yourself for that particular energy. I say that to be a painter, you have to be a juggler, an acrobat. And that juggling is not just the circumstances of making a painting, but you have to make a life. You have to work, you have to support yourself, and you have to make sacrifices in some degree to figure out what you're gonna do to keep painting. Next, please. This is out by Carlito's Ranch. And in this one, it was a straight landscape. And then when I took it back to the apartment, I started manipulating it. And I think it went into that kind of pointillist feel. So at this point I was borrowing from different traditions and trying to develop my own vocabulary. I do think that education, there's a privilege that's attached to it. I did go back to school. Next slide, please. I did go back to school because I realized that I didn't know all the things that I needed to know. And so I needed some training and I needed some other knowledge. These are areas by the Rio Grande and the river. I think that school taught me the discipline of thinking and understanding what the idea of art is about. And I was not connected to that in a great way. My landscapes to me were just pure pleasure. There was an aesthetic sense they were interesting because of the color and the time and the feeling and the light. But I don't think there was anything else attached to them in that sense. Next slide, please. Take me down to the lazy river. Let me go where the sun always shines. Lay me down by the water's edge. Take me to the place where this never ends. Take me down to the lazy river. Let me watch the clouds turn into my friends. Wake me down by the water's edge. Leave me in this place where this never ends. Down the lazy river. Next, please. And so I did a lot of work outside of school. Next slide, please. And then I went back to school. These are the last paintings I did when I was in Santa Fe. I was doing kind of sort of cubic construction of the houses. If you've ever been in Santa Fe, there's a sense, they have a code actually that all the paint and the stucco has to be of a particular type. You can't go out of that domain. Next, please. So when I went to New Mexico State, I had to basically redo most of my undergrad. And so these are undergrad while I'm working full time. And so education is now informing me because I realized I wanted to change. I came down here for a promotion, but I realized that I didn't think I could do another 10 years of the work I was doing, and I needed to find something different. So I invested in myself. And that's what education is about, that development, hoping that it would take me to this other place. The portraits. So at New Mexico State, next please, I was dealing with the developmentally disabled adults that I was working with at the dayhab and the jobs. And these individuals started taking on characters in my paintings. Next slide. There's the quote in terms of the juggler. to keep painting, you have to be an acrobat. But I think that's with almost everything in life to some degree. If you have a family, if you have a relationship, if you have commitments, you have to figure out to balance all that stuff. And I think that that's a great struggle that people have to some extent. Next slide, please. These are early undergrad works where I'm trying to deal with ideas. In this case, I'm doing a copy of a Cezanne while there's somebody who looks like he's doing body work on a body, and someone's cleaning up blood, and there's another figure in the background. I think these paintings were dealing with my own transition, and in some cases, my own struggles and pain with having to figure out what I was gonna do. Next, please. When I say gonna do, work, go to school, and find a place for myself. These abstractions to me are very brutal and very raw, but I did find them interesting. But again, school allows you to explore in some fashion. You're given some parameters and you're able to work through certain ideas to find maybe your voice or something within that. Again, I did not get any technique in school. All I got was a discussion and ideas about what does this mean, what am I looking at, and what are these about. This is a pointillist variation of my grandmother from memory. She was dying in a nursing home at the time, and I couldn't be in California. So I was pulling from this desire, and in some cases, nostalgia, to be somewhere else. And so the work changed, and I started working on family imagery and imagery from people from work. Next, please. This is the dehabilitation painting. And I was asked once, I did get waivers because these are working from photographs. So Karen and Shane and Steve and Sophia, they said, yes, you can paint me. That came up at a discussion once in terms of releases. It was a wonderful experience and a painful experience because of the nature of the population that I was working with. The beauty of it, if you take someone out of an institution and you allow them to have the breath of life, living in smaller apartments with fewer people, having a job or at a dayhab, recreation. Many cases we were finding employment in the community. I was able to have one client marry his girlfriend, which was unheard of. Very much at that time, and from this would have been from 95 to 2000, very conservative environment related to the opening up of this experience. The Halloween painting at the dayhab, where the clients, the individuals get to choose their costumes and their masks and to represent these larger archetypes. When you paint something, it elevates it to this other place. I think the same thing possibly happens with photography, but I think painting primarily did that in the past, where you take these materials and you elevate the unconsidered. Unconsidered. Next painting, please. I was also dealing with portraits. So this is my mother and my grandmother in the nursing home. I was wanting to be in California and I couldn't. So I would go on very quick vacations, take a lot of photographs, and then come back and compose imagery. What was interesting about this, so now I'm an undergrad and I'm learning about the ideas of a painting, how to put together meaning, maybe to shift things up. So in this case, I'm dealing with multiple images of my mother and my grandmother and the staff that's helping her. Next, please. And I'm dealing with the idea of time in a slow way. So this is my sister, morning pattern. So she's drinking coffee and reading the newspaper, and then she gets up to wash the dishes. So there's something cinematic about it. There's multiple viewpoints, interior, exterior light. And I felt that these were had a lot of energy in them. I was really pleased with these paintings. These were the last paintings I did as an undergrad. Next, please. More family paintings. These are psychological studies. So if you take an idea, or I took an idea, okay, a family figure, interior, exterior, multiple viewpoints, and I would run with these series, maybe doing a handful of watercolors and six or seven of them in repetition. So the study of my brother on the red couch, he's thinking of, he's at a Thanksgiving event at my sister's, but he's psychologically thinking that he's gardening with his daughter in the backyard. Behind him is a wall. There's nothing in the apartment, the house it was. So you can superimpose and recreate, redefine space in a painting. And I found that to be really liberating. Same thing with Laundry Day, where that driveway actually is coming into the laundry room and opening up the space in this different configuration. Next, please. Paintings of my sister and her dog, of a similar elk, slightly different. Next. And then more family paintings of events and my grandmother and my uncle, etc. I think the last of them were my uncle and my mom at that series. That's probably as realistic as I get in terms of a portrait. I don't like to spend a lot of time with a photograph. I would prefer drawing from life, but the conventions as they are, it's difficult to have somebody sit for you these days. Next, please. And that was the another one of the Dahab paintings. Next. And the wedding dress. Next. A red strand of copper lifts off on a current of cool air and wraps its length around my head. It rests on my shoulder and hooks on the neck like a question mark, asking for a moment of rest, a nap, an escape from the rush of need, asking for a few minutes of peace, a dream where all things are possible, where yes is now. Next, please. So I've been working on a series for quite a while now, dealing with the envelopment of a figure with some other activated element. And that poem is related to this figure. These are mostly from my imagination. I may pull some fabric or something off a dress off the internet, but the composition of them is basically a conversation. And that's what a painting is for me. It is this dialogue that I'm having with what's going on. And at a point in time, the painting is saying it's going in this direction, and you have to listen to those elements and follow that. Next, please. And sometimes that conversation could take years. I've worked on paintings that I thought were done, and I've seen them later and pulled them out. This was the painting I did last spring break when COVID hit. And so I remember my sister saw a photo of it, and she says, "Why is that woman so unhappy?" And I said, "She has COVID." This is, I guess, in some ways, I process my feelings and my ideas in terms of how I'm thinking about the world. There's this great beauty, and yet the upside down of it is this horrible absence and pain that we're still dealing with. And at this point, much of my work is dealing with still life, a man in a boat, a seascape, and a figure. Next, please. Another from that series. I call it the COVID series. This painting is, you can go back to the next one, the figure study. I would hire a model. Even when I lived in Santa Fe, you can find modeling classes and go draw for a couple hours in the evening. And they used to have it in Las Cruces. I don't know where they have that anymore. But I would hire models to come up in my studio and I would paint them. I think working directly is important because something else happens with the materials and you have to think differently. There's a different space. It's interesting, when I was taking classes in California and first started painting, I would bring a photograph and the instructor said, it wasn't just me, he said, "Everybody, why do you want to paint that? You already have it in the photograph." And for him, and I think he was from that New York abstract school, there was no need anymore for representation in the arts because film and photography does it so much better. But he would say, then you have to change it in some way. And that change is either doing something else with the color or something else with the space. Next. Another figure study. I just like the explosion of what's happening behind her in terms of the energy. Next. Self-portraits. I don't want to spend a lot of time, but I do think self-portraits are important because you can always work your craft with charcoal and a mirror, with painting and a mirror, and these are done from mirrors, which is why there's a lot of strange distortions in them. It's not that I can't copy a photograph, it's like there's this other challenge. Next, please. So these are two of the first paintings I did as self-portraits as an undergrad. And one I look like Toulouse-Lautrec without arms, and the other one I kind of look like Frank Zappa. I was in better shape back then. Next. We'll just move through these. I think it's important, and I tell my students in all my classes, I go, even if you don't paint yourself, you should be photographing yourself every day to see how you go through these changes and what happens to you. I find myself fortunate to be very expressive. They were usually done during a Christmas break, and I would usually come down with a cold or a flu after you put all your grades in. So there's something a little angst about them. But I do like the feeling of them. They're still interesting to me, and I still work on them every now and again. Next. Oh, and that's one I did when I was in, I think, undergrad. That was probably one of the family undergrad paintings. Next. So when I got into grad school, I stopped working the figure because I thought I needed to change. And part of the thing is I felt I was all over the place. So stop here. My idea was, what are my influences? So I'm going now back into, I guess, retreating into myself, into the knowledge, into the books, into the critique. And I'm looking at my bookshelf in my apartment, and I thought, I'm going to paint that as well as I can from life to see how well I can do that. And of course, while I'm doing that, I'm thinking about all my influences. Now, as much as I love abstraction, and I think abstraction is actually more difficult than representational art, I realized that most of the artists that I was interested in were working from life or working from subject imagery. So this is the series of bookshelves. Next. And again, even though I used to do a lot of landscapes, the lesson in school is to do a series. It's not you just do one assignment, do seven of that assignment to see what happens. So I think I have 7 or 8 bookshelves that I've done. They're not quite trompe l'oeil, but they're close to a type of physical realism that is interesting because they feel very tactile, very responsive in a particular way. And this led me to the idea, and now I am in grad school, that next I would paint everything in my apartment. So I did a bookshelf, I did another bookshelf, and another bookshelf. And then I said, well, what if I paint the bathroom door? What if I paint the sink? How well can I paint a pair of scissors? So the first year of grad school was kind of retreating deep into myself. And I would assert that these are actually more self-portrait referential than the self-portraits in a particular way. The things that I touch, the things that I interact with every day. I must confess that the idea was taking the mundane, the banal, and elevating it. This 1970s linoleum tile, and you say to yourself, "Am I gonna be able to do every one of those dots?" And you just have to say, "I'm gonna have to do it until it feels like the linoleum," and you take that challenge on. Next, and I suppose that if it had been a 2-year program, this would have been my thesis work. But it was a 3-year program, so that gave me more time. If what I didn't have in skill, I had an ambition, meaning that You have to work hard. That goes without saying. And if you have some talent, that helps. But working hard will take talent or less talent further than anything else. But you also have to have this sense of luck. And that you can't rely on. But you can be prepared when that luck happens and then ride that wave. I did like this Still Life series. Next, please. I think there may be 10 or 12 in this series. There may not be all in this presentation. What's also interesting, and it became a discussion, hold it here for a second. These were painted during 9/11. And I was painting these statues, and then it was discussed as twin towers, twin people. That was not my intention, but it is what happens in terms of how something is analyzed or viewed from contemporary circumstances. Next, please. And this is one that I painted for Stacy. I had a cousin who died while I was in grad school. So this represents her. Next. And just a chair. We have to write a teaching philosophy. I haven't really worked on it. I've been thinking about it, but if I could condense it, it's this: observe, think, respond, repeat the haiku, discuss. That's very much what most of my education in terms of undergrad and grad school was about, augmented by going out in the world and reading books. Next, please. So I went back into, I left my apartment. Well, I didn't leave it, but I lived here. And then I went into the studio space that the college provided, and I set up these still lives. These became about, I was studying the metaphysical Italian painters, De Chirico, Cara, and Giorgio Morandi. There's a preschool of surrealism that happens in Italy, and they're dealing with archetypes and Platonic abstractions of form that bespeak of larger things. So this actually for me deals with the plane of existence, the plane of attrition, and the plane of heaven, where all things become possible, heaven, earth, and hell. And the houses became metaphorical signifiers for people, circumstances, and family. And again, I did a number of these. Next, please. Just straight still lives, dealing with light, dealing with time. And then the thesis work became about this other amalgam of bringing some natural forms and birds into it. This idea of forms moving into form and falling forms, flowers in this kind of physical space, nature kind of falling and kind of almost like spinning in the wind to some extent. Next, please. You dance like you know me, baby, you move like you're a part of me. Swing in the moonlight, swinging the candlelight. Shadows get to fly and I get to go up like a bird in the sky. When you dance like you know me, baby, I know you too. I just want to make love to you. Next, please. So during this period, I'm still working still lives and dealing with, in this case, mortality and just straight looking at an object and giving it some kind of metaphysical twist, as it were. Next. And more still lives. I'll go back to this one. I recently sold this painting. The skeleton painting. Well, that's okay. This still life actually is, no, go back. That's okay. Go forward, I mean. This still life is actually slightly misplaced. When I was in Santa Fe, I took some classes from the Santa Fe Institute of the Arts from a gentleman who had studied at Yale. Interesting man, Alexander Shundi. And again, it was just like having somebody discuss what I was doing and me discussing what was going on. And I would set up still lifes in my kitchen window and I would paint them. This is the only one, unfortunately, that I have left. My mom wanted it, so it's at her house. But I think there's 7 or 8 of these, and I have no idea where they are in the world. More still lifes and flower paintings. Next. You know, I think, you know, I was in Chicago about 4 years ago now. I'm a big fan of Impressionism. And I think Chicago has one of the finest Impressionist collections that I've ever seen. I do feel that the Impressionists deliver, they don't let down and they edify. I don't think I'm a political painter. And when I was asked this recently, I would say that every mark I make, everything I do is a political statement of liberation and freedom on the canvas. Because in actuality, you can't do that in every culture. You think about the Egyptians for like 5,000 years, you had a set prescribed ideas that could be painted, had to be done a certain way. We are really free in terms of the liberation of what we're able to do just by making art at any level. Next, please. And then the fish and the birds. Next. So I wanted to break away from all this still life, which I thought was slightly dark, and I wanted to shift it up. So I started dealing with tile and pattern and taking the bird elements and the flower elements. And what was nice about these paintings is I was able to let go of gravity. What I realized and what I think most painters realize is the conventions of painting don't have to correspond to the nature of the world and how it is. There doesn't have to be a vase holding a flower. The birds don't have to be actually real. Maybe they're a shadow. And there's this liberation of letting go of those constraints of gravity. Sometimes it's called Neoplatonism. It's why you have Michelangelo figures flying and through the sky in the Sistine Chapel ceiling. There's a sense that you can break the bounds of gravity for poetic reasons. I feel these, not like Michelangelo, but I feel these have that sense of expanded space going on. Next, please. And again, working in series, layering the leaves and the flowers and working through different ideas related to that. I thought these were very buoyant and joyous paintings. There was something light and airy about them. Next, please. Hold it here for a second, Lorena. What I learned most in grad school, you'd put paintings on the wall and the class would discuss them. And the critique is both positive and negative, things that could be improved, things that people maybe don't understand. And you have to work through your own process in terms of understanding what others are seeing, because it may not be apparent to you. I had a hard time talking about my work. I thought I did interesting work. I didn't really know what it was about. This critique, when I did a series of these large floating fish paintings, was the best critique I ever had. Josh Rose, my mentor, walked up to this painting, pointed at it, and just looked at me and basically was saying, do 30 of these. that was the best critique I ever had. Next, please. And by the way, these paintings are very large. That's 70 by 60 inches. This is 72 by 70 inches. So these were very large paintings. I was trying to go big. They're now in a storage locker. I'd like to get them out and show them one day. Next, please. Well, I'm showing them today. Stop here. So those led, I had done a lot of figurative work and they were boring. But when I did the fish paintings, I realized I could superimpose these fish forms on the figures, and that's what I did. So I was dealing with these large canvases, manipulating material. In some cases, I was using sand. I was letting go of the references, and I was just trying to create this sense of energy, rest, sleep, awake, excitement, contemplation, something about the envelope of the movement of these figures in this space. Next, please. And again, I've been working these for a while now, so I try to do at least 2 to 3 a year. These are the earlier ones. Next. These are the most current ones, actually. These were both done this year. And actually, the one on the right was done 2 weeks ago.
So, Professor Rimbach, thank you. Unfortunately, time is pressing us a little bit.
Okay.
If you don't mind, we have a few questions. If you want to do a few, you know, a very quick 60 seconds.
Okay, so do me a favor. Go to the very end. Go to the very end, just so the last 3 slides. Go all the way to the end, Lorena. Just rip through them. Keep going. So, okay. Make me a perfect dream and find me a world I can call my own. And give me the last slide, Lorena, please. And this is available. And I have to say this, this project would not be possible without the help of some people. Studio 77 and Sara Rodriguez helped me edit and organize this book. And I'm internally grateful for her help. It's available on Amazon and Blurb in 3 different forms, hardcover, softcover, and a ebook. And I'm working on a drawing collection as we speak. Thank you so much.
Well, no, thank you. Thank you for such a wonderful presentation. So we have a few questions. I'm gonna go in order. So from Professor Richard Baraka. Hi, Frank. You mentioned the Impressionists and Cezanne as influences. I also see early Picasso and Matisse as influences in some of your paintings. You mentioned Italy. Which Italian painters are your favorites and why?
My favorite is Giorgio Morandi because of how he simply deals with light and space. I was in Florence. I went to Italy 6 years ago now. And so I was in Rome, Florence, and Venice. And I think the Florence frescoes are a high watermark for what one can do with figure, color, and light. It's not that I'm so interested in religious imagery, but it's so gorgeously painted and the surfaces are stunning. But I would have to say Giorgio Morandi.
Great. We have also a question from Jurgen. How do I get a Rimbach original?
Well, you'd have to go to the Mesilla Valley Fine Arts Gallery. I have paintings and some works on paper there. You could email me and maybe we could discuss something you saw in the book. I have some of the paintings you saw. I don't have all of the paintings. Much of the paintings are in collections throughout the United States and Germany, I think. So we could discuss that at a later time.
Great. We have another question from Brack Morrow. Frank, between your landscape portrait. Frank, between your landscapes, portraits, self-portraits, mundane beauty, it seems you have an ecology influx. What do you think your relationship with nature and the Anthropocene as an artist is headed next?
That's a great question, Brock. Thanks for coming to the presentation. You know, I'm always hoping for, and even more so after this COVID experience, a back to nature transcendental movement on the continent. I think getting away from this machine and going out with a drawing pad, a French easel, writing poetry, hiking. When I go out in the world, no one's out there because I do a lot of hiking. So I think we have to have a return to nature to have a greater understanding of what we're doing to nature. We live in a simulacra of this world that we've created, and we're burning it up. And I think if we pull back and slow down, I think that type of work is about recognizing that beauty, that aesthetic quality, and something that you'd want to preserve.
Well, that's great. Are there any other questions that we may have? We have a few more minutes. I actually do have a question, if you don't mind, Frank.
I'd love
For those of us who appreciate art, but unfortunately we're born without any talent whatsoever for artistic expression, do you have any suggestions on how we can express ourselves artistically speaking? We probably have like 60 seconds.
The fact that you're able to speak to me and read what you're reading tells me that you could learn anything. Education is available on every level for the average person. That's a fact. All it takes is the desire and will to do it. You may not be a great piano player, but you will learn chords. I would tell you, Freddie, audit my drawing class. Hopefully when it gets back to face-to-face, you will realize you can learn to draw. If you learn to write, if you learn to ride a bicycle, if you learn to drive a car, it's in you as the human condition. You can do it. It's not talent. It's not talent, something else. It's work and desire.
All right, that's great. So I would like to thank you everyone for joining us during this session. I think that this is a great way to conclude our first day at the Border Learning Conference. Before our final remarks, I would like to, of course, thank Professor Frank Greenberg for such a wonderful and very inspiring session. So everybody, please join me to, show our respect and admiration for Professor Greenberg. Please feel free to unmute yourself and clap or show your appreciation and love with, emoticons and everything that comes.
Thank you, Frank.
Hey.
I'm the love. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm feeling the love.
Thank you very much for everything.
Appreciate it. Thank you so much, Crystal, Freddie, Lorena, Erica, Cirilla, everybody who invited me. Reba, all of you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. So
you can email me if you have other questions about art or the book, or I mean, it's $15 for like the ebook. It was expensive to do because it's expensive. So it's more of a vanity piece for, I think, collectors and my own ego, but yeah.
Thank you, Frank. So for our final remarks, Crystal, would you mind?
Oh, of course. Thank you. I'd like to echo Freddie's statement. This was really a beautiful way to spend an evening. I greatly appreciate hearing the stories, hearing from Frank, hearing from all of our presenters. So if you don't mind, and if we can still, can we give all of our presenters today a round of applause? Bravo. Your hands, right, dudes? Or you
there
can.
It is.
Oh, thank you so much. This is our. We're closing out the first day, and I'd like to also use this time to share a few more reminders. We would really like for you to please use the name that you submitted on your registration form when you join the Zoom session. That way we know who is in our sessions, and also so that you can win some of the prizes that have been donated by the committee. We've got some great gift certificates from local restaurants, and even jewelry from a local business that is run by one of our adjunct professors, Geo Genius, and many more. We have many wonderful sponsors. And we'd like to share these gifts with you because as the participants, you're the reason that we do this and you give us so much, we'd like to give it back. So please, if you would, when you enter the session, would you please use the name that you used on your registration form? And remember that the more sessions that you attend, the higher your chances, your chances to win are increased. So once again, we'd like to thank you. Thank you for the participants who are with us today. It is so good to see your names and sometimes faces, and especially those of you who have been to several of the conferences. You know, I think you understand and appreciate the love that goes into this conference, and we love you back for it. So thank you so much. We'd like to thank each and every one of you for joining us at dinner time, because we do know it's dinner time. Some of us, our stomachs are rumbling, or maybe you were enjoying something delicious in your own home. I think about these Zoom sessions as I do the way that we thought about TV sitcoms in the evening, right? You're inviting everyone into your home, right? While you're experiencing all the busyness. And sometimes you can hear, you know, my cats or dogs or child in the background. So thank you for inviting us into your homes today. Thank you for joining us for dinner time. I hope you ate something really tasty while learning something new or appreciating some beautiful art and poetry. This was truly a lovely evening that really, once again, like Freddie Jaimes said, it encompasses the purpose behind the conference for the stories, the lessons, and the camaraderie. So while we do not get to touch right now, I hope we were able to touch your mind and heart this evening. I look forward to seeing all of you at lunch tomorrow. We've got an amazing, really, I'm really kind of blown away and excited about our lunch panel. I feel like we're gonna really learn a lot, especially during this quarantine. You know, being able to hear from people, from experts, I'd really, I'm excited, so I hope you're excited as well. So thank you again. We'll see you tomorrow and have a great evening.